In this video, we are going to take a good look at the Shirogami No. 2 220mm Cleaver made by Master Blacksmith Kenji Togashi.
That's large.
Why in Shigefusa's name did I buy this beast of a blade? How do you actually use it? And for what exactly? Are there any advantages to having a blade like this in your kitchen? Watch the whole video to find out. Hello, my fellow chef knives enthusiasts. Ever since I've started watching cooking videos of Master Chef John, I always wanted to invest in a quality Chinese cleaver, or as the Chinese call it, a kai dao. But I didn't want to buy one of the usual suspects. I wanted to buy a kick-ass cleaver made by a master blacksmith from Japan. Then one day I came across a cleaver made by master blacksmith Kenji Togashi.
Oh, here we go. What's up with this Kenji Togashi fella?
This is what Onno de Weert, owner of Karasu Knives in Amsterdam, had to say about Togashi knives after he paid him a visit in Japan.
One very interesting visit in Osaka was Togashi. Very old, very well-known blacksmith working with his sons. Very small workshop, full with machines. There's four spring hammers, and two big forges there. And Togashi is very well-known for his white steel and honyaki knives. He had a big case in the entrance with the medal he got from the emperor, and I think he's the only blacksmith who had one. Of course, Dento Kogeshi, so he's a certified traditional craftsman, but we got to see them forge a little bit. Very noticeable that they took a lot more time than the other blacksmith we saw on each individual knife. I was a huge fan of Togashi knives, but now I'm even more. Yeah. Not only the forging, but the sharpening on Togashi knives is extremely high quality, with the finish and the polish. They really add to high quality knives. And we have a picture, me and Tony, with their longest tuna knife, so a Maguro Bocho. We had to hold it with the two of us. It's single bevel, of course, not pre-laminated, so they have to forge weld, and they have to organize the whole shop. They have to make a special forge for it. And when he sharpens it, he has to open the doors on both sides of his sharpening so that the two points stick out. It kind of felt like the most special visit in Sakai. Togashi knives, yeah, happy to have them. Top notch, yeah. You should get a cleaver, a Togashi Chinese cleaver. Yeah, those are nice. I have one, but that's extremely big. I mean, that's large.
Yeah, this is a beast.
Yeah, you can do some flexible work with this.
I just couldn't resist. A 220mm Chinese cleaver made by Kenji Togashi in Shirogami No. 2? Shut up and take my money.
Why would you buy another huge knife?
This is a fine looking blade by Master Kenji Togashi. I really like the traditional Japanese vibe that this knife has going on. Nothing really fancy. A simple whole wood handle with a black buffalo horn ferrule. It's a thick handle, of course, because it has to complement this huge blade. Kenya Togashi, the third son of Kenji Togashi, he does all the in-house sharpening and grinding, and he does it well. Yeah, the knife edge is formed ultra fine, and I like the thin geometry of the blade in general. For a hefty blade like this, it is very thin behind the edge. The grind has a very subtle convexity to it on the right side of the blade. On the left side of the blade, it is more flat. The spine looks a little bit thinner than the middle of the blade, so it kind of reminds me of a traditional German Walkschleife grind. So the thickest part of the blade is in the middle of the blade, not at the spine. It probably means that he grinded this knife with the idea to minimize stiction and maybe enhance the food release of this blade. The profile is obviously a large rectangular shape, but it has quite some curve on the belly. The fit and finish are looking better than on most Chinese-made Chinese cleavers. The choil and spine could have been rounded and smoothened a little bit more, but there's literally nothing wrong with this blade. The knife is built with a hard core of a Shirogami No. 2 steel, which stands out by its purity and thereby the ability to get extremely sharp. Due to the purity of the Shirogami No. 2 core steel, you may expect a relatively rapid patination when used. The beautiful bluish, orangey, gray patina gives the knife charm and character, in my opinion. But at the same time, it forms a protective membrane against further oxidation of the surface. The Shirogami No. 2 core steel is cladded on both sides with soft iron. Iron cladding apparently is easier to forge weld, which is a plus for the blacksmith, but it's also a little bit softer, so easier to thin out and also easier to polish on stones to achieve a really nice finish. Stainless cladding tends to clog the stones and be a little bit more abrasion resistant than soft iron cladding. As a patina lover, I don't mind that soft iron is obviously more reactive than stainless steel. However, if a knife that I really like only comes in stainless steel cladding, I probably definitely would still get it. If you are not a patina lover like me, go for stainless clad knives, or maybe even a stainless blade altogether. It is much easier to keep these looking nice. And if you live in a tropical, wet climate, stainless clad should probably be more of a preference to you as well. The Mighty Cleaver. The Chinese really love to use this impressive piece of equipment in the kitchen. But important side note, a Chinese cleaver isn't meant to whack and hack through bones or nothing that you don't want to bite through with your own teeth. Rather, it is more like a gyuto, a chef knife, and apparently it is great for multitasking when it comes to chopping, cutting, slicing vegetables, fruits, and meats. If you have the proper knife skills and technique, this is a blade that can do everything. Better yet, in the hands of a classically trained Chinese chef, it is literally the equivalent of a gyuto. And then some. As far as I can tell, after using this knife just once or twice, there are a few more little advantages to a Chinese cleaver compared to a gyuto. Obviously, the wide blade length and surface of a Chinese cleaver efficiently scoop and transfer chopped ingredients from the cutting board to the cooking pot or pan, streamlining the cooking process. Another useful aspect of the very wide blade is the ease of guiding it. By resting the knuckles of your hands that's holding the food down against the blade, you can chop fairly quickly without fear of injuring yourself.
Remember, kids, don't play with these knives unless you've still got both thumbs.
Another possible advantage of the Kai Dao is its weight. You're able to let that weight do a lot of work for you when cutting ingredients. It also comes in handy when using the back of the blade, the spine, to tenderize meat. I would never do that with a lighter weight blade myself. I use quite a lot of ginger in my kitchen, and you know, you can use a grater to get the flesh out of the ginger, but I also found that I can use my cleaver to kind of whack and scrape the ginger. Look at all this flesh coming out pretty easily. The fibrous mostly stays on the piece of ginger you're holding and scraping. So what is left is the soft, fleshy part of the ginger on your cutting board. The weight of this blade also can be a little bit of a disadvantage, of course. It's not very easy to wield and not very nimble. But again, that weight is mostly an advantage. Crushing or smashing a clove of garlic, I can put a lot of force on the surface of this blade without the risk of really bending the blade. Crushing a walnut shell is no biggie at all. And perhaps the most fun advantage of a Chinese cleaver like this is that you can scare your housemates or neighbors with this thing.
Yeah, nothing says stay off my lawn like brandishing a cleaver.
I did play around with this blade a little bit in the past few days, cut quite a few veggies with it, and it's definitely a vegetable slayer. I cut some chicken thigh with it. I didn't cut any fruits with it yet. Is watermelon a fruit? Tomato is a fruit? Whatever. And I actually cut a homemade burger with it for you know, for no reason whatsoever. This is definitely cutting whatever it is that you want to cut, as long as it is edible. But I have to say that this knife is going to take a little bit of time to get used to. I can't just pick a 220mm Chinese cleaver for the first time and perform all the essential knife skills with it on the cutting board. This knife makes me feel a little bit clumsy and a little bit uncomfortable. You and me definitely need to get to know each other a little bit better. But yeah, I feel that it's going to be a fun challenge. Maybe I'm not intelligent enough to immediately understand and bond with a kaidao. It feels a little bit like overkill. I mean, what am I doing? This thing dwarfs my tinker tank. It is that huge. But it's just so cool. It's just so... so cool. The first and second time I used it, I experienced it as a little bit too heavy and clumsy for vegetable prep and way too delicate to be used as a Western cleaver. Also, it has a little bit too much belly for my taste, a little bit too much curve on the cutting edge. But I guess there are many relevant use cases for a classically trained Chinese chef. I will just have to figure out step by step, cut by cut, how to put every part of this blade into use. Am I ever going to be as good with it as a random Chinese cook? Probably not. Do I care? No. I'm just happy to own one of these. Did I expect my first Kenji Togashi knife to be a 220mm cleaver? Nah, not really. But I find myself staring at it almost every day. Once in a while, I will take this knife to the cutting board and just enjoy slaying vegetables with it with a smile on my face. I would like to take a quick moment to give a little shout out to you, the knife nerd community here on YouTube.
Without you, he'd just be a guy talking to his knives. Even with you, he's just a guy talking to his knives.
I can't believe that a few people actually decided to support my channel by becoming a member. Special shout out to Kim Huliganga, who became my first member about 9 months ago. My man Alessandro Fossa came in as a close second. Andrew Elliott, Nate Blackmore, you guys rock. I have never asked any of you to become a member of my channel because frankly, I have no time to create and provide extra perks and content for you. I mean, the only thing you gain by becoming a member of my channel right now is that you can watch my videos a week before they premiere to everyone else to see. So yeah, if that is worth $2.99 a month to you, or you just want to show your appreciation for all the time and effort I put into my content, go forth and become a member of my channel. Have it your way. Also, a quick shout out to the trolls and haters.
It's not like you can hurt his feelings or anything. He's got the emotional resilience of a potato.
Whatever other people think and say of me is none of my business. I don't care. It's called inner peace, bitch. You should try it. As always, thank you for tuning in. I hope to see you in the next video. Bye, folks.